Good morning, and welcome to the hot FCC summer and the July open meeting of the Federal Communications Commission. Madam Secretary, would you please introduce our agenda today?
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. Good morning to you. Good morning, commissioners. For today's meeting, you will hear three items for your consideration. First, you will consider a report and order to ensure that when there is a communication service outage that potentially affects people's ability to reach the 988 lifeline, the commission and those who provide life-saving 988 crisis intervention services receive timely and actionable information. Second, you will consider a report and order and further notice of proposed rulemaking, which would adopt rules to enhance tribal communities' access to the E-rate program by streamlining certain program rules, making tribal college and university libraries eligible for E-rate support, and reducing administrative burdens in the program. The commission will also seek comment on ways to further improve and simplify program rules for all E-rate applicants. Third, you will consider a report and order allowing a limited group of existing Channel 6 low-power television stations to continue to provide analog FM radio services as an ancillary or supplementary service under specified rules. This is your agenda for today. The first item on your agenda is titled Ensuring the Reliability and Resiliency of the 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifeline Amendments to Part 4 of the Commission's Rules Concerning Disruptions to Communications, Implementation of the National Suicide Hotline Improvement Act of 2018. And it will be presented by the Public Safety and Homeland Security Bureau. Deborah Jordan, Chief of the Bureau, will give the introduction.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. Before we proceed to the Bureau's presentation of the item, I want to welcome a special guest to our open meeting to provide some perspective on the importance of the 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifeline. It was just over a year ago that this easy-to-remember 988 number became active for both voice calls and text messages. And we are honored to be joined remotely today by Monica Johnson, the Director of 988 and Behavioral Health Crisis Coordinating Office at the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, which oversees the 988 Lifeline. Over to you, Ms. Johnson. Oh, I don't think we can hear you.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you loud and clear. Thank you so much.
Okay. Okay, thank you. All right, so happy to be here today to give you guys some background on the critical work of 988. So the 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifeline is a critical resource for this nation. The resource must be available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, without disruption, to provide people that are experiencing a crisis with someone to talk to, someone to respond, and a safe place to go for help if that is what is required. Too many people across the United States experience suicidal, mental health, or substance use crises without the support and the care that they need. In 2021, we know a few things related to the data about this. Nearly 900,000 youth ages 12 to 17 and 1.7 million adults attempted suicide. There was approximately one death by suicide every 11 minutes. Suicide was the second leading cause of death for people ages 10 to 14 and 25 to 34 years old. Suicide rates increased significantly among non-Hispanic Black and American Indian and Alaska Native people. More than 107,000 people died from drug overdoses. The transition to 988 from a full 10-digit number was an immense and critical step forward and offered an unprecedented opportunity to strengthen and transform how we imagine crisis care and deliver it in our country. The Biden-Harris administration investment and bipartisan support has invested nearly $1 billion into the 988 Lifeline in recent years. This does not include mental health block grants and other federal money that supports behavioral health care systems. This $1 billion includes funding from the American Rescue Plan and Bipartisan Safer Communities Act as part of the president's unity agenda to address the mental health crisis this country is experiencing. A lot of this funding has gone to states, territories, tribes, and crisis centers to hire crisis counselors and improve capacity and response time so when an individual is reaching out by dialing 988, they can be attended to as quickly as possible. The remainder of these funds have been crucial. They have helped in many ways, running up our national backup system, launching and expanding services for the priority populations that you heard me reference before, and improving training, workforce communication, technical infrastructure, and our ability to collect data. Developing a coordinated awareness campaign with our partners at all levels of government and community. We have recently reached our first year anniversary of the launch of 988. In the year since rolling out this three-digit number, the line has answered nearly 5 million contacts, nearly 2 million more than the previous 12 months following the $1 billion Biden-Harris administration investment. Of those nearly 5 million calls answered, about 665,000 were texts. Compared to the 12 months before, that is an increase of over 1,000%. And you can also chat with 988. We saw an increase there of over 141%. The average speed to answer decreased previously from 2 minutes and 40 seconds. Now we're around 37 to 41 seconds. Of the 5 million contacts in the past year, almost 1 million were answered and routed to the Veterans Crisis Line. The 988 Lifeline links to the Veterans Crisis Line, VCL, which military members, veterans, and their families can reach by dialing 988 and quickly pressing option 1 to be connected to the VCL. In addition to making enhancements across the existing 988 technology system, bolstering cybersecurity, and introducing a new learning management system for crisis counselors, the 988 Lifeline has also expanded services for the following populations: Spanish text and chat services to expand Spanish call services, which have been in place since 2006, along with over 240 additional languages provided through translation services through the language line. Following a successful pilot, we added specialized services for LGBTQI+ youth and young adults who want to connect with a counselor specifically focused on meeting their needs. In the coming months, 988 will also add video phone service to better serve individuals that are deaf and hard of hearing, and this is their preferred method of communication. We have a very bold vision for the future of crisis care in this country. This vision is built on a belief that everyone experiencing a mental health crisis should have someone to talk to, someone to respond, and a safe place to go. The successful implementation of the 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifeline is a leap toward realizing this vision by providing an easy-to-remember portal for care for anyone experiencing a crisis and a network of call centers across the nation with trained crisis counselors ready to answer calls, texts, or chats from people 24 hours, 7 days a week. The overarching goal of transforming America's behavioral health crisis system is to save lives by serving anyone at any time and from anywhere and in a manner that promotes linkages to ongoing local supports and care. The implementation of 988 is a tremendous step forward to achieving this goal, but a crisis care system with 988 at its core cannot be built overnight. Transformation of this scale takes time and depends heavily on the state, territory, support, collaboration at all levels between federal, state, tribal, and local governments. This past year has shown us that the 988 Lifeline is just that, a literal lifeline to millions of people in this country. We received this testimony that I want to share with you from a person who contacted the Lifeline to make this real for you. This individual said, "I searched on Google to locate information on how to peacefully die by suicide. However, the first search result I found was information on 988. I decided to reach out to 988, and I'm so thankful I was connected with the assistance and guidance I needed instead of the assistance I originally searched for. Here's testimony that we've gotten from a Spanish bilingual program coordinator, crisis counselor. He called because he was about to attempt suicide. He was heartbroken, crying, and devastated. He felt that he couldn't take the pressure of being a provider. By the end of the call, he thanked me and said he wouldn't be alive if it wasn't for our services and resources. What if one of these people had not been able to access 988 in their time of crisis? Missing one call is missing one too many. Our partnerships with the FCC and the VA have been crucial to the year's 988-related successes and will remain crucial as we move forward with expanding services and building out the crisis care continuum. I would be remiss here if I didn't acknowledge and thank the FCC for your vital role in establishing 988 as the new 3-digit, easy-to-remember, replacing the old 10-digit number. Without your leadership, we would not be here today discussing this critical resource. We strongly support the FCC in this necessary action of proposed rulemaking, which aims to minimize the likelihood of outages and ensure redundancies are in place in the event of any future outages. 988 must be available in all modalities without interruption, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The nation is counting on us. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman.
Thank you so much, Ms. Johnson. As we deal with the technical issues with 988 here today, I just wanted to make sure we had the opportunity to hear from someone who is working on mental health. And I also wanted to reinforce the partnership that we've developed with the Department of Health and Human Services, and in particular with SAMHSA. So thank you so much for your work in the past. And of course, we'll work together going forward. I appreciate your time today.
Thank you so much.
And with that, I will turn it over to Deborah Jordan, the Chief of the Public Safety and Homeland Security Bureau.
Good morning, Chairwoman Rosenworcel and Commissioners. Today we present a report and order designed to improve the reliability and resiliency of the 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifeline, which provides 24/7 access to our nation's network of more than 200 crisis centers and the Veterans Crisis Line. Thanks to action by this commission, 3-digit dialing to the 988 Lifeline became nationally available 1 year ago this month. Since that time, the 988 Lifeline has answered nearly 5 million calls, texts, and chat messages. The ability to call and reach the 988 Lifeline timely and consistently is crucial to ensuring that people experiencing a suicide or mental health crisis receive immediate support. However, this past December, the 988 Lifeline suffered a nationwide system outage that lasted several hours, rendering this vital service inaccessible to voice callers. Once the Department of Health and Human Services became aware of the outage, they were able to notify the public of other ways to reach the 988 Lifeline, such as through the Lifeline's chat and texting services. Today, the Bureau presents a report and order, which includes rules that would help ensure that when an outage impacting the 988 Lifeline happens, the outage is reported and the right people are quickly notified so callers can be redirected so they can receive the help and support they need. Now to present today's item, with me today are Austin Randazzo, Associate Chief in the Public Safety and Homeland Security Bureau, and Tara Shostek, Attorney Advisor in the Bureau's Cybersecurity and Communications Reliability Division. I'd like to thank the Bureau staff who worked on this item, as well as other bureaus and offices that contributed to this item. Now to Ms. Shostek, who will present the item.
Thank you, Chief Jordan. Good morning, Chairwoman Rosenworcel and Commissioners. Today's report and order is designed to ensure that the Commission, the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Service Administration, which is also known as SAMHSA, the Department of Veterans Affairs, and the 988 Lifeline Administrator receive timely and actionable information about 988 service outages. The report and order would require cable, satellite, wireless, wireline, interconnected voice over IP providers, which are also known as originating service providers, and a new category of covered 988 service providers to report outages that potentially affect the 988 Lifeline to the Commission's Network Outage Reporting System, which is also known as NORS, and notify SAMHSA, the VA, and the 988 Lifeline Administrator about those outages. Similar to the Commission's existing rules that require reporting and notifications of outages that potentially affect 911. Specifically, the report and order would adopt rules that require originating service providers and covered 988 service providers to report outages that potentially affect the 988 lifeline to the Commission's NORS, similar to the Commission's existing rules that require reporting of outages that potentially affect 911. Outages that potentially affect the 988 special facility include any event that lasts for at least 30 minutes and results in the loss of the ability of the 988 lifeline to receive, process, or forward calls, potentially affecting at least 900,000 user minutes. Under the order, 988 outage reports would be required to be filed consistent with the processes and timing required for reporting other outages in NORS. The order would also allow SAMHSA and the VA to apply for direct read-only access to NORS data, consistent with the Commission's existing NORS outage information sharing procedures. In addition, the report and order would adopt rules that require originating service providers and covered 988 service providers to provide notice to 988 special facilities when an outage that potentially affects a 988 special facility occurs. 988 special facilities include SAMHSA, the VA, and the 988 Lifeline Administrator. Providers would be required to notify these 988 special facilities with the same content, by the same means, and with the same timing and frequency as the Commission's rules currently require for 911 outage notifications. To reduce burdens on providers, the report and order declines to require 988 notifications to be sent to public safety answering points or to the more than 200 local crisis centers to which 988 call messages are routed. The report and order also declines to require outage notifications to include contact information for those callers that failed to connect to the 988 lifeline since the outage began, as more study is needed to determine whether this is technically feasible. In addition, the report and order would adopt rules requiring originating service providers and covered 988 service providers to exercise special diligence to maintain accurate, up-to-date contact information for 988 special facilities, just as the Commission's rules require for 911 special facilities. The Bureau recommends adoption of this report and order and requests editorial privileges for technical and conforming edits. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We will now hear comments from the bench. We'll start with Commissioner Carr.
Thanks so much to the team for your work on this really important item. I know that the FCC's work on this started years ago and it's already paying tremendous dividends. You know, a lot of what we do gets, you know, interesting headlines in D.C., but I think this is one of the most sort of enduring and important initiatives that we've had the chance to work on. And a couple months ago, I had the chance to visit a 988 call center in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and I talked with some of the call takers that are there, Alicia and Scott, and they talked to me about the impact that they're seeing as a practical matter from the transition to 988. One of the things that they talked to me about was that the number of calls or texts that they're seeing increased from about 260 a month on average under the 1-800 number to 800 a month now with 988. And the numbers are even sort of more, they're sort of a more revealing fact than just the number is what they explained is that when people called 1-800, the suicide prevention hotline, a lot of times people had a very sort of narrow view about what that number was intended to do. That was purely for suicide right when you were at sort of the peak moment of crisis. And with 988, there's sort of been a different branding so that people are now calling in, not just more people, but they're calling in at an earlier phase in the crisis life cycle, which can be easier to de-escalate at that point in time. And so we're getting more people calling, we're getting more people reaching out at an earlier stage, and people are associating it with a broader set of mental health challenges that they can get help from. So really, you know, tremendous upside that, you know, I don't know that we fully could have appreciated on the front end, but I'm glad that we've gone down this path. And this item has my support, obviously, which seeks to sort of ensure that we have a robust reporting and outage process to make sure that this system works. So thanks again to the team for the hard work on this. Thanks to the chair for bringing it forward. Has my support.
Thank you. Commissioner Starks.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairwoman. One number has really stuck out that we heard here this morning, and that's 5 million. That's the number of calls, texts, chats that we've heard that the Suicide and Crisis Lifeline has received in just that 1 year, since we required that the Lifeline be reachable by an easy-to-remember three-digit number, of course, 988, so that 5 million. Behind that number, of course, are people young and old, men and women, children, veterans, those living in cities, those living in rural areas, all reaching out, of course, at their time of need. Last year's number reflects a 35% increase compared to when the Lifeline was only reachable via that 10-digit number. So again, think about that 5 million. Increased usage is no doubt a metric of success, but we cannot slow down when it comes to providing potentially life-saving services. I'm proud of our telecom community for not really, for not taking its foot off the gas here. There was an outage in December 2022, and by January of 2023, we proposed rules to ensure that the commission, our federal partners, the veterans, the 988 administrator, all would be swiftly notified of any subsequent outage so that people that need to reach the Lifeline could be redirected, rerouted to those alternative channels. And so today, 6 months later, we're adopting those rules. That follows the lightning pace that we're at here for the FCC and our providers, of course, following and working with us in establishing 988 and text to 988. There is, of course, still work to do. Awareness of Lifeline, the service providers must increase, and the service it provides must increase. Wait times for those contacting the Lifeline have dropped tremendously. Stakeholders will need to work hard to ensure that an increase in awareness does not reverse that great trend. As always, on cross-cutting issues like this, I'm glad to see lawmakers, advocates, all working together to serve the people. I'm proud of the FCC's role in doing so as well. Thank you to the commission staff. Thank you to the chair for bringing this very important work at a very steady clip here, 5 million. There's a lot behind that number, and the team has played a tremendous role as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Symington.
Thank you. So I'd like to thank the PSHSB staff and also give a special thanks to Director Johnson of SAMHSA for your work on the 988 Lifeline and also for the remarks today. I'm happy to support this item, setting up an outage notification regime for the 988 system, similar to the one that we've set up for the 911 system. Mental health crises can be as serious as any other medical emergency, and the unavailability of the 988 system could keep someone from getting help when they need it most. Much appreciated.
Thank you, commissioners. It was a year ago this week that the 988 hotline went into effect. Thanks to the work of this agency, anyone, anywhere in this country can call or text this easy-to-remember three-digit number for the Suicide and Mental Health Crisis Lifeline, and they can do it at any time. Now, the numbers show the early success of our efforts. During the past year, we saw a nearly 50% increase in the number of calls to 988 when compared to the 10-digit number that had been used for Lifeline in the past. And texting, functionality I insisted we add to 988, has proven even more popular than calls. All told, there have been, as Commissioner Stark said, 5 million people who have reached out to 988 in the last year. The numbers demonstrate just how deep the need is for this resource, because those are 5 million people who found a place to turn, someone to listen, and a way to receive support. This week, I visited with the Latin American Youth Center in Washington to talk about 988. This is an organization that helps young people transition to adulthood. The community they work with is low income and often unhoused. One of the intake managers told me nearly all of the young people she signs up for services have used this number, some multiple times. This week, I also spoke with the Trevor Project and Whitman Walker Institute about 988 and the communities they serve. LGBTQ youth are 4 times more likely to attempt suicide than their heterosexual peers. Not because they are inherently more prone to suicide because of their orientation or gender diversity, but because of how they are mistreated and stigmatized in society. Watch the cruelty in the discourse in our country right now, and if we don't find a way to stop it, these numbers are only going to grow. These discussions were a reminder that when it comes to mental health in this country, we actually have real work to do, Remember also that great programs like 988 do not thrive without continuous attention and care. And at the FCC, we commit to that care today and doing our part. First, in this order, we take steps to make sure 988 is reliable. In December of last year, the hotline experienced a brief nationwide outage. Today, we establish rules that require reporting and notification in event of any future 988 outage, just as we require with 911. That means any hotline outage will be recorded in the network outage reporting system, and this information will be shared with the Department of Health and Human Services, the Department of Veterans Affairs, and the 988 administrator. Like with 911, it is vital that any problems with 988 are shared fast with the right people so we understand what went wrong and we can make it right. Second, we know we have work to do to continue to publicize the new three-digit number. I hope my colleagues will consider visits to do this in September during National Suicide Prevention Week, and throughout the year, we will be happy to work with each of you to help make that happen. Third, we are working with our partners at the Department of Health and Human Services, and specifically the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, who we heard from just a moment ago, because we're working to find ways to better connect people who reach out to 988 to resources in the communities where they actually make that call or text. Right now, we have underway a trial that tests routing 988 calls from those in crisis to make sure they receive care where they are, rather than just based on their area code. We are mindful that this is not just a technical matter, because when it comes to healthcare, there are vitally important issues with privacy and security. And as we develop technical solutions, we want experts in mental health to be there with us every step of the way. But we are making real progress. Thank you to those responsible for this progress and all of these efforts. And that includes Brenda Boykin, John Chapa, Rochelle Cohen, John Evanoff, David Firth, Amanda Garcia, Shaber Hamid, Ryan Hajpeth, Deborah Jordan, William Kang, Nicole McGinnis, Erica Olson, Austin Rendaza, Tara Shostek, and Rachel Ware from the Public Safety and Homeland Security Bureau. Heather Hendrickson, Michelle Slater, and Christy Schumann from the Wireline Competition Bureau. Stacey Jordan and Alex Yankovich from the Office of Economics and Analytics. William David Wallace from the Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau. Matthew Warner from the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau. Jeremy Marcus, Ryan McDonald, Victoria Rendazzo, and Shauna Yates from the Enforcement Bureau. Deborah Broderson, Douglas Klein, Marcus Mayer, Anjali Singh, Shin Yu, and Bill Richardson from the Office of General Counsel. And Joy Ragsdale and Shauna Wilkerson from the Office of Communications Business Opportunities. And with that, we will proceed to a vote on the item. Commissioner Carr.
Approve.
Commissioner Starks.
Approve.
Commissioner Symington.
Approve.
The chair votes aye. The item is adopted with editorial privileges as requested. Madam Secretary, will you please announce the next item on today's agenda?
Madam Chairwoman and Commissioners, the second item on your agenda is titled Enhancing Support for Connectivity in Tribal Communities, and it will be presented by the Wireline Competition Bureau, and Trent Harkrader, Chief of the Bureau, will give the introduction.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. Mr. Harkrader, please proceed.
Good morning, Madam Chairwoman and Commissioners. The Wireline Competition Bureau is pleased to present for your consideration a report and order and further notice of proposed rulemaking that, if adopted, will make a variety of improvements to the E-rate program to encourage greater participation by tribal applicants. I'd like to thank the Bureau team, of course, and our colleagues in the Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau's Office of Native Affairs and Policy, the Office of General Counsel, the Office of the Managing Director, the Office of Communications Business Opportunities, and the Office of Economics and Analytics, all for their hard work on this item. With me today up at the dais is Jody Griffin, who's head of TAPD. Janae Schreiber, who runs the E-rate team in the division. Johnny Roddy, who's gonna present the item. And last but certainly not least to my right, Sue McNeil, who has led this in the front office. All of these folks have been crucial to getting us to where we are today on this item. Johnny, over to you.
Thank you. Good morning, Madam Chairwoman and Commissioners. Today's report and order and further notice of proposed rulemaking, if adopted, would simplify and improve the E-rate program rules for tribal applicants and encourage greater tribal participation while also seeking comment on other improvements for all E-rate participants. The E-Rate program provides support to eligible schools and libraries for affordable, high-speed broadband services and internal connections to connect today's students and library patrons with next-generation learning opportunities and services. Last year, the Commission expanded access to the program by clarifying that tribal libraries are eligible to participate in the E-Rate program, which helped open the door for tribal library applicants to access E-Rate support. Last November, the Commission launched the Tribal Library Pilot Program, which provides one-on-one assistance to tribal library participants, many of whom applied for E-Rate funding for the first time. Tribal libraries still face many challenges in gaining access to E-Rate support. If adopted, this report and order and further notice of proposed rulemaking would help address these challenges while also seeking comment to address challenges faced by all E-Rate applicants. First, the order grants E-Rate eligibility to tribal college and university libraries that also serve as public libraries in their communities, allowing us to provide support in tribal communities that we may not have reached before. Second, the order creates a new competitive bidding exemption for libraries seeking funding for Category 2 equipment and services totaling $3,600 or less per library in a funding year in order to reduce the burden of applying for E-Rate support. Third, the order modifies our Category 2 rules to increase funding for tribal libraries by raising the discount rate to 90% for the equipment and services needed to make broadband accessible throughout the tribal library, and by increasing the Category 2 five-year budget funding floor from $25,000 to $55,000. Fourth, the order provides guidance on cost allocation rules and procedures that have caused confusion for applicants by permitting de minimis ancillary use of E-Rate-funded internet services. Fifth, the order adopts a definition of tribal for use in the E-Rate program to ensure that tribal libraries can be properly identified so they may benefit from the earlier mentioned Category 2 rule changes. Sixth, the order adds a tribal community representative to the Universal Service Administrative Company's Board of Directors to increase tribal leadership at USAC, benefiting E-Rate and other Universal Service Fund programs through the perspective that a tribal representative will provide. Seventh, the order directs USAC to provide increased outreach and training to tribal libraries. Finally, the FNPRM seeks comment on further program improvements and simplifications for all E-Rate applicants. The staff recommends adoption of this item and requests editorial privileges. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We will now hear comments from the bench. Commissioner Carr.
Thank you so much to the team for the hard work on this. I've had the chance to spend time on a lot of schools on tribal lands and see sort of firsthand, you know, the challenges that come with needing increased connectivity. And a lot of times the libraries and other facilities there can serve as really important anchor institutions. And so I think, you know, today's decision goes a long way to clear some of the regulatory underbrush that can allow a lot of these institutions to leverage E-Rate in a way that's going to make sense and hopefully expand connectivity and open up to more people. I've seen it everywhere from halfway out the Aleutian Island chains and a town of Unalaska, which is where Dutch Harbor is, which was made famous, I guess, years ago from Deadliest Catch. I don't know if that still is a show that's on anymore. But I had a chance to visit, you know, the school there and talk to them about how they're leveraging.
Don't worry, you're not dating yourself.
Exactly. How they're sort of leveraging E-Rate dollars and benefiting it. And I think that there's some obviously unique things that come with connectivity on tribal lands. I think this decision is one that tries to identify those and make sure that our approach to E-Rate makes sense in light of those unique features. And so it's a decision that has my support. Thanks.
Thank you. Commissioner Starks.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairwoman. I was excited, of course, when we adopted an NPRM earlier this year to update our E-Rate rules. Supporting those living on tribal lands is imperative given how many truly struggle with access to broadband. And so in approving that notice, I wrote even then that I hoped that we would move quickly. And I'm proud that we've done so here today, Madam Chairwoman. I strongly support today's item, which continues our efforts to expand broadband access in unserved, underserved locations, making tribal college and university libraries that serve a wider public eligible for E-Rate funding. And it also implements changes which will ensure that all eligible applicants can easily access E-Rate benefits. E-Rate, of course, is a crucial source of support for those schools and libraries on tribal lands and their surrounding communities. I heard and saw this in May, traveling with Senator Ben Ray Luon to visit the Pueblo of Santa Clara. There we met with Governor Chavarria and heard firsthand from tribal members the importance of E-rate funds in the Pueblo. I also experienced this last month in Alaska, where I was fortunate to be able to visit several remote villages of indigenous Yupik people. I visited Oscarville, a village of about 100 people, Napaskiak, a village of about 400, both on the banks of the Kuskokwim River. As we pulled up in a motorboat, neither of these villages is accessible by road. I was immediately struck, of course, by the number of kids running around who would stop and kind of peer at us as folks who seemed a little bit out of place, for sure, but yeah, just a little bit. But they were riding on their bikes, riding on ATVs, because most of the way that folks get around there is on a boardwalk. The ground is permafrost. And so many travel, of course, moving quickly on ATVs. I saw a dad truly with five kids kind of clinging and hanging and riding on the back. It was quite a sight. But these communities may be remote, but their educational and connectivity needs are very real. Napaskiak is home to the K-12 school serving the school area of villages, and it is for sure the largest building that I saw there. On the same trip, I had the opportunity to visit with leaders of the Kenai Peninsula Borough School District, just a borough that is as big as West Virginia, and a proud recipient there of E-rate funding. Everyone I met with, from the assistant superintendent to the IT manager there, spoke about the vital role that E-rate plays in funding their students and their successes. I got to see the district's network room humming, racks of servers literally being powered with our E-rate dollars. And I always find it valuable to get out and see, of course, how our programs are functioning, actually doing the work in connecting Americans and our youngest minds as well. So I'm glad we've taken this step today to promote additional broadband deployment and adoption on tribal lands. It should expand the E-rate program well. I'm proud to support this result here today. Thank you to the hard work from the team.
Thank you. Commissioner Symington.
Thank you. Yes, I'd also like to thank the staff for their work on this item.
Thank you, Commissioners. Last December, I drove west from Albuquerque to the Pueblo of Laguna, and I visited their tribal library. When I was there, tarps and plastic sheeting covered the bookshelves and computers. The space, which the library aide assured me was usually bright and warm, was damp and drafty due to water damage, but repairs were underway. The same library aide explained just how vital it was to fix this facility. In a typical year, 20,000 patrons visit the library and hold more than 10,000 internet sessions. For so many people in this rural community, this tribal library was how they connect to the larger world. What stayed with me most from this visit, however, was a binder on a shelf by the desk of the head librarian. It was bulky. It was chock-filled with papers and forms, and it was labeled E-rate. The binder made clear what conversation alone did not. Tribal libraries like this one are working with so many constraints to figure out how to get broadband connections they know their patrons need. But navigating this program is not easy for so many of the facilities that need it most. This was a theme that came up again and again during the Tribal Libraries Tour that the Office of Native Affairs and Policy recently held. It included discussions and visits with Alaska Native communities and the Morongo Band of Mission Indians, as well as listening sessions with representatives from nearly 24 tribes. Now we are acting on what we heard and what I saw that day at that library at the Pueblo of Laguna. We're making steps to make it easier for tribal libraries to participate in the E-rate program. Remember, these are facilities in some of the most remote areas where broadband is scarce and community access at the library is essential. So we're cleaning up our rules and streamlining our process so that more libraries in tribal communities can seek support through E-rate. To this end, we expand eligibility for more tribal facilities, we simplify forms, and we simplify procedures. On top of this, I'm pleased to announce we are extending our existing tribal libraries pilot program for an additional funding year. This program, which offers tribal libraries one-on-one assistance navigating the E-rate application process, has been really well received, and we believe it can help more tribal libraries in more places. But the benefits actually flow in two directions, because along the way, we can learn more about what it is in our rules that impedes small libraries in Native communities from participating. For this effort and for coordinating our engagement with tribes and developing the Tribal Libraries Tour, I first want to thank Bambi Krause, who leads our Office of Native Affairs and Policy. And I also want to thank so many people who worked on this, including Max Adkins, Callie Calder, Kate DuMichel, Jody Griffin, Trent Harkrader, Sue McNeil, Molly O'Connor, Johnny Roddy, Janae Schreiber, Haley Steffen, and Lisa Zana from the Wireline Competition Bureau. Ediel Casperalta, Lloyd Collier, Derek Goetzen, Alejandro Roark, Jill Springer, and Kara Voth from the Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau, Melina Barzilai, Michelle Ellison, Richard Mallon, William Richardson, Anjali Singh, and Shin Yu from the Office of General Counsel, Warren Fishine, Eugene Kisilev, and Shane Taylor from the Office of Economics and Analytics, Danielle Daly from the Office of Managing Director, and Michael Gasso, Jocelyn James, Joy Ragsdale, and Shauna Wilkerson from the Office of Communications Business Opportunities. We will proceed to a vote on the item. Commissioner Carr.
Approve.
Commissioner Starks.
Approve.
Commissioner Symington.
Approve.
The chair votes aye. The item is adopted with editorial privileges as requested. Madam Secretary, please announce the next item on today's agenda.
Madam Chairman and Commissioners, item 3 on your agenda is titled Amendment of Parts 73 and 74 of the Commission's Rules to Establish Rules for Digital Low-Power Television and Television Translator Stations. The item will be presented by the Media Bureau, and Holly Sauer, Chief of the Bureau, will give the introduction.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. Ms. Sauer, please proceed.
Good morning, Chairwoman and Commissioners. Today, the Media Bureau presents a fifth report and order related to the operation of analog FM radio services by Channel 6 digital low-power television stations, a service more shortly known as FM6. Joining me at the table are Sean Maher and Robin Fagan from the Video Division, and Evan Morris, Associate Bureau Chief of the Media Bureau. Robin will present the item her first.
Good morning, Chairwoman and Commissioners. Because the FM radio spectrum band is adjacent to the TV spectrum band, the audio portion of analog Channel 6 TV stations can be received at the bottom of the FM radio dial. Starting in the 1980s, some Channel 6 low-power TV stations have utilized this proximity to provide programming for FM radio listeners. With the completion of the digital television transition in July 2021, the digital audio portion of the FM 6 station signal could no longer be received on FM radios. In an effort to preserve FM 6 operations following the digital transition deadline, the Media Bureau granted special temporary authority to 13 FM 6 stations to continue analog radio operations. After multiple comment cycles that have spanned nearly a decade and 2 years of operations by FM 6 stations under special temporary authority, this order finds that it is in the public interest to preserve these existing FM 6 stations on which listeners have come to rely. The order finds that these stations have demonstrated that they can undertake FM 6 operations without causing interference to either their own digital television service or adjacent channel FM services. As such, this order will permit continued FM 6 service by these existing stations as an ancillary or supplementary service. The order also adopts technical and operational rules governing how FM 6 stations will be permitted to continue to provide FM 6 services in order to ensure that they are offered in a manner that does not cause interference and remain consistent with the public interest. Finally, the order declines to repurpose on a nationwide basis television channel 6 spectrum for FM services in locations where TV channel 6 is not currently being used to provide television service. It also declines at this time to amend the Commission's TV6 interference rules. The Media Bureau recommends that the Commission adopt this fifth report and order and requests editorial privileges to make any necessary or technical or conforming edits. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We will hear comments from the bench. Commissioner Carr.
Thanks so much to the team for your work on this. I have a longer and more interesting statement for the record, but you'll have to, you know, wait till it's posted on the website and then go reload and read it there. But for now, I'll just say thank you so much for your work on this item. I really appreciate it. Thanks.
Commissioner Starks.
Yes, thank you to the team for their work on this item. Thank you.
Commissioner Symington.
Thank you. I'd also like to express my appreciation, as this is the fifth RNO. This was a long time in coming, and there's been a lot of very careful work on this, so much appreciated.
Thank you, Commissioners, and thank you for acknowledging it's been a long time in coming, because it was back in the 1980s, remember that? On a small number of low-power television stations operating on Channel 6 began to provide supplemental audio programming. They took advantage of the physics of their location on the broadcast television band because the uppermost portion of the channel where these television stations made their home was also capable of reception on the lowermost portions of the FM radio dial. So far, so good. Because ultimately, this led to more broadcast services to more people in the community. But when the low-power digital television transition rolled around about 2 years ago, this got complicated fast. That's because when these stations upgraded to digital transmission, they were unable to reach their analog radio audience. For the past 2 years, we have kept these stations on the air with the regulatory equivalent of gum and bailing wire. We set up a temporary process that allowed for use of separate analog radio transmitters in combination with a digital television facility. Now it's time for something sturdier and more permanent. In light of the fact that we've had 2 years of experience with this arrangement and no incidents of interference with television operations and adjacent licensees, including other stations on FM radio, we are authorizing these FM 6 stations to continue providing radio service as ancillary or supplementary services under the Communications Act. And all of that may sound really technical, but to the communities these stations serve, it really matters. Right here in Washington, for instance, WDCN La Nueva is one of those stations. Broadcasting out of Fairfax, Virginia, it is targeted to those with ties to Central America, and it features public service programming, music, and content from El Salvador, Honduras, and Guatemala. This is a small station that is a big deal to its audience. We make it possible today for them to continue to broadcast to their radio listeners because we know in a world where content feels like it is everywhere, there is still something special about a local radio signal that comes to us in the air. So thank you to the team responsible for this effort, including Jim Bradshaw, Mark Colombo, Robin Fagan, Tom Horan, Barbara Kreisman, Sean Mayer, Evan Morris, Holly Sauer, and Al Schaldiner from the Media Bureau, as well as Dave Conskal and Anjali Singh from the Office of General Counsel. And with that, we will proceed to a vote on the item. Commissioner Carr.
Approve.
Commissioner Starks.
Approve.
Commissioner Symington.
Approve.
The chair votes aye. The item is adopted with editorial privileges as requested. And before we conclude, let me ask, would any of my colleagues like to make announcements at this time? Commissioner Carr.
I do have one. We sort of did a release on this earlier, but some staff changes in my office. So I want to start by expressing my thanks and appreciation to Danielle Thuman, who with her small and growing family has relocated to North Carolina. And unfortunately, as a result of that, has left our office, but we wish her all the best. She really brought a depth of telecom and policy experience and expertise to the office and provided really invaluable guidance on a wide range of issues. So she was a real talent and superstar for us. So I want to thank her for her government service and wish her all the best in the private sector. So that means we have a new addition to the office as well. And I'm delighted to welcome Lauren Gary as a legal advisor to the office. She is well known to a lot of people in the building. She joins us from the Wireline Competition Bureau. She was in TAPD for a little while. You know, a lot of bright minds come out of there, among other places in the building, not being exclusive there. Most recently, she was the designated federal officer for our Precision Ag Task Force, so working on a lot of rural connectivity issues there. She was a law clerk earlier for an ALJ in the Department of Labor. She spent some time in Congress as a staffer as well. And so she's got really a deep breadth of policy experience and legal expertise, obviously, that we're going to draw on. So we're really glad to have her in the office. She's already been contributing very well, hitting the ground running, which is great. So we're really excited to have Lauren in the office, and hopefully, for those of you that don't know her, reach out, have coffee, get to know her. I think she's gonna be great, so thanks.
Thank you. Any announcements, Commissioner Starks?
Nothing from me. Congratulations to Danielle on what's next for her and for her family, and look forward, of course, to working with you and my staff as well, Lauren. Thank you.
Commissioner Symington.
No announcements of my own. Congratulations to
All
Danielle
right.
and Lauren.
Get comfortable. I've got a few. John Kuzma is retiring at the end of this month after a 20-year career with our Chicago office as a field agent. He was a really productive field agent, and he had very high level of technical skills, and he was able to resolve some of our most challenging cases most quickly. And when we asked him about his future plans, he told us he plans to acquire personal aircraft and continue his flying endeavors, so we wish him go forth into retirement and into the skies. John Stein retired from the commission at the end of last month. He provided 37 years of dedicated public service, with 31 years of it at the commission in the office of the Chief Information Officer. And he contributed extensively during those three decades to transforming and evolving the commission's information technology capabilities, specifically engineering services and solutions. We are really fortunate to have had his service for such a long time, and we wish him the best in his retirement. Now, I've got a few announcements that are a little closer to home in my office, so let me start with some changes on my team. First, Priscilla Delgado Ardris will now serve as my chief counsel, transitioning from her role as chief legal advisor. She joined my office from Meta, where she focused on spectrum policy issues for the company across the globe. She is someone who I've had the privilege of working with at a lot of different points in my professional life, and she is so smart, so savvy, and so calm under all circumstances. I am thrilled to have her guidance and uncommon good judgment in this new and more prominent role. Now, in coordination with Priscilla's new role, I want to announce that Ramesh Nagarajan will serve as chief legal advisor in my office before serving as legal advisor and joining us on the 10th floor. No, not the 8th floor. Ramesh was the deputy division chief of the Competition Policy Division of the Wireline Competition Bureau. And in his short time in my office, Ramesh has become really invaluable. His intellect and can-do attitude have helped us navigate so much to date, and I'm looking forward to having more of that in his new role in the future. And then finally, I'd like to highlight one of the newest additions to my office, Rashawn Duvall. She's now serving as acting legal advisor, pitching in on the Affordable Connectivity Program and a whole bunch of other technical wireline issues, including universal service policy. She joins us from the Wireline Competition Bureau, where she most recently served as Assistant Division Chief in the Telecommunications Access Policy Division. So with all that moving up, there's also some moving out, and I have one announcement to make that's a big one. My Chief Counsel, Umair Javed, is leaving my office and leaving the Commission. The most important things I have to say about Umair, well, today it's just that we're going to be holding a party for him tomorrow at noon in this very room, and I'd encourage everyone to join us. I'll have a lot more to say at that point, but for starters, let me acknowledge that for my office and the commission, Umair was the proverbial firefighter. He was the steady hand who could get us past whatever issues might arise. And the truth was, that's not all that was remarkable about Umair. He's actually literally a firefighter, because in his free time, he stays up all night at the Loudoun County Volunteer Fire Department answering emergency calls and helping save lives. So we're going to thank Umair for his service at the commission in Loudoun County and, of course, in my office, where during my time both as commissioner and as chairwoman, he has been a sounding board for so much that I've worked on, a reliable spectrum enthusiast, no matter how technical the issue, an eager researcher, and a terrific writer. On top of that, he's been a tireless champion of the public interest and a wonderful friend. So, Madam Secretary, would you please announce the next date for the commission's monthly agenda meeting?
The next agenda meeting of the Federal Communications Commission is Thursday, August 3rd, 2023.
Until then, we stand adjourned.
Good morning, everyone. If we could take any outside conversations to the foyer or elsewhere, we'll get started in a couple of minutes with the chairwoman's post-open meeting press conference. For those who haven't met me before, I'm Paloma Bettis, the press secretary for the agency, and I'd like to welcome Chairwoman Rosenworcel to the podium. We'll be taking a couple of questions.
Good morning and happy heat wave July. Why don't we get started fast? We'll start with you, Matt.
Chairwoman, thank you very much. I'm going to, since there's few of us, I'm going to slip in two questions with you. The rip and replace applications were due this week. Can you give any kind of characterization, a sense of how they've come out? Is there a total? And with my second question, caveat that I'm not asking about specifically lead cables that we know exist in the ground that have raised environmental concerns. I'm not asking about that issue that you can't comment about, but hypothetically, with telecommunications equipment, that legacy telecom equipment that raises environmental concerns, what role, if any, might the FCC see itself playing in something like that? Thank you.
Okay, well, first things first, as you asked about rip and replace, this Monday was the deadline for carriers interested in reimbursement to file with us. I believe when I last checked, we had 126 carriers that had done so. Right now, we have funds to support their efforts to take out insecure network equipment that amounts to 39.5% on cents on every dollar. In other words, we are short of the total amount needed, and we are going to continue to work with Congress to make sure there's a full appropriation. The carriers have a year to remove this equipment under our program, so this is just the start of the process. It's only the beginning. And with respect to the other issue you discussed, we take health and safety issues very seriously. We're spending some time looking at the Communications Act, trying to understand if issues like this have ever arisen before. But more importantly, we've reached out to the Council on Environmental Quality at the White House and the EPA because we want to discuss with them what their plans are, and we want to figure out how we can assist them going ahead. All right.
Hi, Madam Chair.
Hi.
Just wanted to ask you whether you have a sense of whether the FCC nominees, including the two incumbents, will receive Senate votes before recess, but maybe more generally speak to the urgency you see in that, especially the latter part of the year is focused on appropriations generally.
Congress created this agency to have five commissioners, and I think we function best when we have five. But I also know that I don't have a crystal ball to tell you what the future holds, but I hope that the day when we have five comes sooner rather than later. All right. Thank you all.
Thank you, Chairwoman. And I'm going to call up my colleague, Katie Gorsak, who will be leading the Bureau press conference.
Okay, thank you very much, Paloma, and welcome to the Bureau press conference. We'll be going in the order of the items voted today, and we'll be only taking questions on today's meeting items. We'll start off with our first item on the report and order for 988. I see Matt has a question, so if y'all could come up.
Thank you.
Matt Daneman, Communications Daily. I guess sort of a two-parter. Is with the order that was approved today, is there any harmonization of when these reporting rules go into effect, harmonization with the updated 911 outage reporting rules? There have been some industry concerns that they might sort of not jibe with timing. Was there any change made in the order that was approved to any kind of harmonization? And then my second question is, were there any notable changes from the draft to the finalized order? Thank you.
So we did align the deadlines for today's 988 notification rules with the deadlines for PSAP notification that was requested. And so there were some edits, not substantial, and you know, they'll be forthcoming as soon as we can get that out.
Chris, did you have any questions? Great,
thank you.
All right, moving on to the report and order and further notice to propose rulemaking on enhancing support for connectivity in tribal communities. Any questions, Matt or Chris? Okay, moving along. So our final item today is a report and order on preserving local radio program presented by the Media Bureau. Do we have any questions on that item? Okay, I'm off the hook. All right, that concludes our press conference, and I believe Commissioner Carr is in the room. I don't know if he's going to be coming up here, but looks like he is. Thank you so much.
All right, good to see the intrepid two reporters that are here. Looks like our numbers have been dwindling steadily over the next year, but maybe we'll get some more attendance in the fall. We'll see, but happy to take any questions that you all have.
It's the humidity. We're a week sweating group. So.
Exactly.
Similar to what I asked the chairwoman, I'm wondering, what role do you see or do you hope to see the FCC playing in addressing or looking at environmental concerns regarding these lead telecom cables that have raised a lot of concern? Where do you see the FCC having any kind of role to play? What do you hope to see this agency do, if anything?
Yeah, well, Thanks. Look, obviously, you know, concerns about lead when they're raised are ones that we should take seriously. You know, at this point in time, with respect to the story from the journal that came out, I think, you know, we're at a point in time where we just need to get some more facts at this stage. I don't think we're ready. I'm not ready, at least, to sort of jump to any conclusion one way or the other. I think the chair indicated some interest in working with EPA on the issue. You know, look, I'm open-minded at this point, but I do think, you know, we're sort of at the fact-gathering stage at this point, not ready to sort of reach a final conclusion about what role, if any, different agencies would have.
Hey, Commissioner. It seems like there's been more pressure lately on the issue of whether to classify streaming services as virtual MVPDs. I wanted to see if we could kind of gauge your opinion on that, whether to reopen the record on that issue, outstanding since 2014.
Yeah, look, it's an issue that I've been tracking. I've taken, you know, meetings on all sides of it. It's obviously sort of a complex issue. It's one that when you look at it from the Communications Act perspective, there's certainly, you know, concerns raised about, you know, generally, does the Communications Act itself need an update to deal with some of these issues? But, you know, I'm still open-minded on the issue, still taking meetings on the issue, but, you know, don't have a particular perspective to share on it right now.
It's kind of a follow-up. This item on circulation about independent video programmers, is that connected to the virtual MVPD issue?
I'm still looking at that one. I don't believe it's sort of directly tied in. I think it's sort of it sounds similar, but I think it's a separate issue, but we're still working our way through that circulate.
Thanks.
Any last question? Any question from staff? Everybody's good? All right, we'll see you next month, which is just a couple weeks away. Thanks all.